What is up, Squared Nation? Welcome back to No Counters, No Combos. And today, we're going to be talking about some minor tech options that I've been experimenting with, you know, recently with the, the release of Set 11 and the meta just kind of shaping out and shifting forward to what we've experienced with Set 10. Now, obviously, I'm playing more on a budget style than, you know, maybe like 65 to 70% of the community is right now. But what I've noticed lately is that there's a lot of different trends and a lot of different patterns I've seen, you know, when it comes to facing off opponents. You know, we're in a unison heavy format right now, and it seems like for the most part, you know, your opponent's turn to play is going to try to be dropping their unison down so they can start accruing value off of their unison. Of course, that doesn't mean that every single deck is playing unisons on turn two. It really depends on the situation, but more often than not, I'm seeing a lot of patterns where unisons are coming down on turn two. And then, of course, you know, my strategy as well. You know, I play a couple of decks that have, you know, a restricted two cost unison that I want to try to get on board as soon as possible. You guys have seen my gameplay video with the Future Trunks deck, where on turn two, I'm jamming down Supreme Kai of Time unison because that's what the deck wants to do naturally. So with that being said, this unison heavy focus that we've gotten in set 10 and we're going to extend upon in set 11 and set 12, there's really only a few ways to interact with your opponent's unisons, and that's just by, you know, turning sideways and, you know, throwing battle cards at them. Now, it's going to get a little more difficult with set 11 because we do have a lot of unisons that have, you know, 15k base power. There's some unisons with 20k base power, so it is going to be, you know, a kind of pick and choose type of strategy when and when not you want to push your opponent's unison. I mean, you know, for example, the Dark Broly unison, the green Dark Broly unison that we're getting in set 11, he's a 20k body and he has some built-in hand destruction elements. You know, so it's going to be very difficult to deal with stuff like that. So obviously there are a couple of things that are very important when it comes to dealing with unisons. You know, any type of multiple strikes you can do, whether it's double strike or triple strike or quad strike. You might not want to waste a quad strike on a unison, but you get my point, you know. Any type of multiple strikes you can do, anything with dual attack, triple attack, stuff that can restand and swing multiple times. And what I wanted to talk about today, any battle cards that you can cheat in for, you know, very minimal energy investment. And what I mean specifically is a very, very long time ago, I want to say maybe set two or maybe it was like set two or set three, we got our first iteration of combo into play battle cards. I'm going to pop up some images for you here on the screen. You know, for blue, we had the Raging Spirit Son Gohan. We had the SS2 Vegeta for red. We had the, you know, based form Frieza for yellow. And I believe green didn't get a combo into play card for one energy until Tournament of Power, which was Kawe the Keymaster. They did have TN, which obviously that was a very formidable card back in the day with people playing Cell Chain. You did have your TN, but it was a combo for two energy instead of one. So green didn't get their one play combo until Tournament of Power, like I said earlier. So the reason I want to talk about those cards is because they're 15k base power, they're three costs or less, so there's not a lot of counterplays that can hit them that target two or less. Obviously, you do have to watch out for any type of interaction your opponent can make with you when you're trying to play that card, whether it's if they have a unison in play and they can free play their counters, or if they have enough energy up to disrupt the play. But for the most part, you're making a minimal investment and you're not going to be doing it on your turn. So there's a couple of things strategically to look at. You know, for the most part, these cards are, you know, you tap one energy, combo it, and then after you combo with it, depending on your color restrictions, you get to play the battle card in rest mode, which is very good because if you're playing it defensively, you get to reap the benefits of having another offensive threat on your turn when your opponent decides to pass over to you. Now, why did I say before about it being a more strategic thing? So here's the thing, right? If you're playing a battle card into play, your opponent does have that counter timing window, but they're going to have to respond to it on their own turn. So they're going to have to make the decision, do I want to let my opponent build up their board and then also continue to play more threats on their turn? Or should I deal with this threat now? So it does kind of become a game within the game, you know? If you want to counterplay, whether it's, you know, God Ceiling Trunks or God Ceiling Technique Trunks or, you know, Charismatic Villain with Frieza, they do have to make that decision to play the counter and then obviously remove the battle card from the field. But if it's on their turn, you're still going to have free or you're still going to have utilization of all your energy when it comes to your turn. So I like playing those little game within the games with my opponents because to me, you know, for one energy, I'm comboing out of an attack, so I'm not going to take damage. And then I get the added bonus of playing a battle card on the board. Now, I'm at the mercy of my opponent. Do they decide to counterplay that card and stop me in my tracks, or do they decide to let it go? Either way, for me, I'm looking at it virtually as a win-win. Because worst case scenario, they counter my card and it dies, but now they wasted one of their counterplays. So it's one less thing I have to worry about later as I decide to further my game state and play my actual deck strategy. Best case scenario, they ignore it and I get essentially a body on board that I could use that I just paid two less energy for it. And I can use it to start either swinging at their battle cards or swinging at their unison and removing their markers. So I wanted to kind of get this out there because they are older cards. I'm sure, you know, people are still utilizing them because they are good in my opinion. Anything that you can play for less energy than its printed cost is always going to be good in the game. So I just kind of wanted to get it out there for those players who are newer or those players who are looking for type, you know, options to be able to play battle cards on the board for less energy. You know, the Bardock Ape that we got in the anniversary box is also a very good option. There are a little bit of restrictions with that card. You know, it is a unique, so you can only have one at a time, and then it does lock you out of playing non-yellow Saiyans for the rest, you know, essentially as it's permanent. So you can't really, you know, advance your game state if you're playing non-Saiyans. You can't really play a unison card, but these older combo into play battle cards, there really aren't any restrictions except for the color that you're playing. And because each color except black has one, you could essentially decide what you want to do moving forward. Now, I think the strategy works best in blue decks because blue has always been a very defensive deck and they can utilize restanding and recycling their energy. So when you have, you know, energy open to do extra things with, you know, being able to combo into play a 15k attacking battle card is not a bad option. So I would say experiment with the card pool. I mean, there can be a lot of value. There can be a lot of merit in being able to play stuff like that. You know, if you're looking at the Universe 7 archetype, they have the Android 18 that's specific to Universe 7. But pretty much every color has a, you know, one energy 10k combo into play card. You know, back in the day when the Mono Red Pan deck was very effective and very successful, The one drop combo into play Vegetas were very, very crucial with that strategy because you can play them defensively. You get a 15k body on board, you proc Pan's auto, you get to draw a card. So you essentially start filtering more cards out of your deck, and it's a red 15k power that with Fearless Pan is going to get double strike later to threaten for lethal. So it was a pretty efficient strategy when I played that deck back in the day, and I'm just translating that success that I've had in the past to now having it in the future. Now, obviously, when you're playing against aggro decks and stuff like that, you don't want to tap out, you don't want to utilize your energy for stuff that's not going to essentially stop your opponent, as opposed to just kind of delay them. So you do have to pick and choose what you're playing against when it comes to that. But as we're moving into this unison heavy format, into the set 11 format that's focusing a lot more on monocolored, and you know, it's seeming to be slowing the game down a lot. You know, Joey from Crossworld TCG talks about his favorite playstyle of the game being mid-range, and I could definitely see that moving forward. I mean, you do have to worry about aggressive options like Broly and maybe, you know, Reboot Gohan if it's still going to be a thing. But other than that, I think there's a lot of room in this game for mid-range strategies. And naturally, as that, you know, starts to happen, as people start playing later and later into the game and they have more energy to utilize, your combo into play battle cards are just going to get more value because they're going to save you defensively, and it's going to get you a body on board that you can either use it offensively or you can, you know, absorb an attack from one of your opponents because they don't want you to advance your board state. So let me know in the comment section down below what you guys think. These are just really good, cheap budget options if you're looking for just cards to be able to play on the board. And I just wanted to see what you guys thought, if you know, about my thought process, you know, coming with these combo into play battle cards. I've had success with the blue, Gohan combo into play with the Trunks deck. And I'm probably going to try, other versions of those battle cards specific to the leader color. I mean, obviously the Bardock Ape is a really good one for yellow, but I haven't really tried SS2 Vegeta for red or the green counterpart just yet. So I just figured, it's something to try out, especially now. We did have the unfortunate announcement that the 2020 championship events have been canceled. Not canceled, but they're going to, they're going to rely on having webcam events or in-store events, depending on your state restrictions and stuff like that. So, it's going to be a lot harder to get more competitive events going. But if you're playing on a local level, or if you're playing in a 1K or something like that, and you want to try different strategies and, experiment with older cards that we've had released, with obviously this vast card pool that we have right now, obviously more affordable options, that's what we're all about here. So we're trying to make sure that you can enjoy playing the game of Dragon Ball Super, but also save as much money as possible. So let me know what you guys think in the comment section down below. Don't forget to like, share, comment, subscribe, and we'll see you in the next video. Be there or be squared.